So I had a really long title. First of all, I want to thank the organizers for inviting me. I have never been to a Topo Europe meeting, and so it was very nice. It's very nice to attend. And I see that there are a lot of young people here, students and postdocs, and so that's wonderful. And Claudio told me once that he would like these meetings to become venues for a lot of discussion, especially the young people. So may I suggest that when undoubtedly you will have questions about my talk, that the first talk go to either a graduate student or a postdoc, which is what we do at the Gordon Conference, and it seems to work really well, and it gives a venue for younger people to ask questions. I shouldn't say younger, junior, right? Okay, right, so I had a really, really long title, but the bottom line and the only sort of take-home message that you should have, which comes as no surprise to geologists, is that details matter, right? But the question is, and I had a nice conversation with Laurent Husson on the long way here, about what kinds of details matter and what can you learn? Because just saying, you know, or your conclusion being complex, something is complex, is not a real conclusion, right? And that's what Laurent said, that's a direct quote. And he's right, is the details matter insofar as they tell us something about the Earth, not for the local precise situation, but the physics of the mantle and the lithosphere in general. Now, it is no surprise that, you know, the system is complex and the details matter. All you have to look is that it's a topographic map like this, and you will see some very interesting things, right? First of all, there are regional patterns, you know, related to mountain belts or so on. There are global patterns, the fact that the hypsometry is bimodal, and there are local patterns, right? So we have global, local, and regional patterns, and you have a great deal of variability and complexity. And that tells you something about the physical processes by which topography arises. Okay, let me apologize because it seems like all my slides are slightly off, and I'm not sure why in terms of the quality. So what are those contributions to topography that give rise to something so complex at the surface? Here's a cartoon actually produced by James Wookie at the University of Bristol, and it sort of encapsulates nicely how topography actually depends on everything from the core mantle boundary, you could even argue core flow, all the way to lithospheric processes at the surface. We're very familiar, of course, at long, even at shorter wavelengths, with the fact that there is a large contribution due to the lithospheric structure, or crustal structure, thickness, density, plus whatever contribution the mantle lithosphere gives. Right, we have contributions from orogenesis, which gives rise to mountain belts, and those might be short wavelength uncompensated, but certainly tectonic in nature rather than dynamic. But you also have some long wavelength topography, in some cases short wavelength topography, that depends on flow in the mantle. And this is what we call dynamic topography. Right, and dynamic topography is not a slogan, as Peter Molnar says. It is much more than that. Dynamic topography is a process by which mantle convection directly affects the surface. Process isn't the right word. Because dynamic topography does not depend on the buoyancy itself being right underneath, like in the case of isostasy, but it's related to the radial stresses, the vertical stresses due to convection impacting any boundary across which there is a lateral, there is a density contrast, inherent, bulk compositional, not thermodynamical. What that means, however, is that to understand topography at the surface at long wavelengths, and in some cases at short wavelengths, such as basin formation or flooding of continents, you need to understand mantle structure. And so we need to understand when we see a picture of tomography, this is really old, this is one of Adam Zawanski's first tomographic models, but you saw in Karen's talk and in Hitoshi's talk, very advanced, very fine resolution tomography with sharp boundaries, we need to understand where those things originate from. And to understand that, of course, you know, we have to keep in mind that the origin of size, what we see in tomography, they're velocity anomalies. They're variations with respect to a one-dimensional model, and they can be affected by temperature, the presence of fluids, composition, and they can also be affected by crystallographic phase changes. But looking in more detail, you saw some of the pictures that are related to past subduction, perhaps. Let's look, in fact, at how some of that mantle structure is generated by the plate tectonic processes that we see at the surface. So here is a picture of some plate motions reproduced in a finite element model by Gorski. modeler. And the point is not the model itself, it's actually just to illustrate tectonic boundaries. Because what you see here when you see a slab is you see the oceanic lithosphere entering the mantle, but as someone asked, I think it was here, you know, when that enters into the mantle, it's not just the oceanic lithosphere with its crust and its mantle, but also some of the sediments that are going in that are going to contain fluids. But it's also going to be whatever generated that oceanic lithosphere at the ridge. And so let's pick a ridge there. I think that's a ridge. Okay. And what happens when you generate oceanic crust and oceanic lithosphere if you want at the ridge? What you're doing is, in fact, generating continuous thermal and compositional heterogeneity that goes into the mantle. You can understand that oceanic lithosphere as a thermal boundary layer of the convecting system. This is certainly what it is, whatever the rheological complexity is in the mantle. But it is also a way to continuously differentiate the material because of partial melting. So you're generating a basaltic crust. And a residuum underneath, let's call it Hartzburgite, which has a different composition than the initial source material. So you're generating a package that is compositionally stratified, not even sort of accounting for the sediments at the top, and that is entering signals into the mantle that will be picked up by the seismic tomography, for example. Okay? So the details of that generation start to matter, and they start to matter perhaps at short and long wavelengths. Now, this, of course, has been recognized for a long time. This is a paper by Oxford and Parmentier for 1977. And it's the fact that generating oceanic lithosphere generates a package that is very differentiated in delta rho. You might not think it, but 0.1 grams per centimeter cube is a huge delta rho in terms of convection, in terms of driving convection. And you have a lot more than that. So you can end up with a package of oceanic lithosphere if you have enough crust and if you have enough depleted mantle that is less dense than what's underneath. And if the entire package is less dense than the surrounding mantle, then the process of convection and what signals that convection might give becomes interesting. Okay, so in which way might it become interesting? I'm going to come back to this. So here's just to give you a flavor. I show no equations, but in fact how I do the model, so we can talk about that later. But because I talked about mantle flow, what you need to know is that to compute anything that I show, right, say radial stresses at the surface that give rise to dynamic topography, I need to do a convection model. In this case, I do very simple, instantaneous, one-step convection models where you input a density heterogeneity, be it one that you made up or one that you derive from tomography. And then what you do is compute from those radial stresses what the topography might be at the surface, and this is the dynamic topography contoured right here from sort of positive to negative, forget about the amplitudes, that's not important, for South America for the case of two very distinct models of what the subduction might look like. One, which is of course not very realistic, where you have a slab that it's essentially vertical going down, and also with a density structure that does not account for that compositional stratification that I was talking about, or any variation along strike of that slab. And this is what you predict, of course, a dynamic topography that is very focused along the trench, right? So you would have any sort of basin very close to the margin right there. But suppose that now you take into account the fact that South America has a great deal of variability along strike in terms of the morphology of the slab, in terms of the geometry, and also in terms of the density structure. It, not only is it a young slab, we know it's probably the oldest part, at least today, is about 40 million years entering into the trench, but also there are these very well-known features, these aseismic ridges in this case, where at least in one case, a very thick oceanic crust has been found. If you take into account that density structure, the morphology itself gives you a pattern of dynamic topography that is very different, right? And the amplitudes change radically when you take into account the fact that the delta rho due to compositional stratification and thickened crust is now no longer denser than the mantle. Okay, so why is that important? Because details such as the variation in the change of the dip angle are actually affecting a relatively large long wavelength field. Now, why do we care? Why should we at all care about whether these details matter? What is it telling us about the physics of the mantle? So this is a sort of a compilation of reasons of why you should care. But basically, the interaction between the radial stresses generated by convection that can come as deep as the core mantle boundary is actually impacting the surface directly. This is not just plate tectonics as the expression of mantle convection. This is a physical deflection of the surface, and therefore it will impact on the tectonics, and it will also impact, for example, on climate. Okay. So if it's so important and it's so interesting, and now the details at perhaps the regional level are starting to matter, what do we actually know about dynamic topography? Okay, so I'll start with the observation side. Observation in quotes, because there's no such thing as an observational dynamic topography, right? Almost everything, well actually everything, that you can derive in terms of dynamic topography, it's a model, right? Just like the isostatic contribution is a model. Right? So what we know in terms of topography, the data, okay, you can measure it, the topography, the rest, a lot of it is inference and interpretation. Okay, so here are four different models. This is from a recent paper by Flamand et al., where these are expanded in spherical harmonics, so smeared out, of four different residual topographies. And those are the observed dynamic topographies. And what you see here is a great deal of similarities. These have been done in different ways. In one, they've just subtracted a mean. In one, only the crust is participating in the isostasy, and so on. And you see a lot of similarities. But at the local level, and even not so local, you see a lot of differences. Okay? The other thing that you see is that these are very, very large amplitudes, right? And I find it hard to believe, and in fact, it's probably not there, that there is as much as 4 kilometers peak-to-peak dynamic topography in the Earth that it's hidden somehow by the isostatic contribution. And in fact, if you go into detail and say, if you just look at South America, this is my own lithospheric model, which I'll talk in a minute, these things are different. They're different to the point that you can predict, you know, something that should have a negative deficit versus a positive deficit in terms of the dynamic topography of the central Andes. Now, why is that? And why is it that, you know, these things are so different? So it comes down to, you know, looking at the topography locally and realizing what are the contributions to it, okay? And what are the things that we need to know? We need to know the thickness. This is a map of the MOHO depths derived from GOES data and GRACE data, I think, as well. So this is the thickness of the crust, right? You also need to know what the density of the crust is. Now, this is the density contrast at the MOHO right here, but you need to know more than that. You need to know the density structure of the crust. You need to know the thickness of, say, an upper crust versus a lower crust. You need to know whether, you know, how dense the lower crust may be, for example. And you also need to know that compositional stratification, similar to what I talked about for the oceanic lithosphere, for the continental lithosphere. That is, how do you form lithospheric mantle? Do you form the continental crust by a continuous process of partial melting differentiation? In which case, you would have a depleted mantle that would be very important in terms of its contribution to the isostasy. The other thing that's important is, compared to some of the models that are shown before, is whether you think only the crust is important for isostasy, or do you think, or in other words, whether you think the entire mantle, including the lithospheric mantle, participates in convection. The other thing you need to know is something about geology, right? You need to know what the tectonic provinces are, so as illustrated in this map here. And the tectonic province will tell you something about the age of the continental lithosphere, about its thermal age, about its thermal structure, right? Are we talking about accreted terrains? Are we talking about cratons? Right? And that will change what you infer in terms of the lithospheric structure, in terms of its thickness, and in terms of its density. So we try to do just that, just so that we could come up with an observed dynamic topography model, as funny as that sounds, that could be used to then, you know, look at the predictions from dynamical models, both at long wavelengths and at short wavelengths. So this is one such attempt. It's not published yet because the student left and I haven't gotten around to it. Which is to divide, you know, forget about what some of these things mean, which is to divide the continents into tectonic provinces, the oceans as a function of age, and then together with some information about the thermal structure of these tectonic provinces and of the half-space cooling of the oceans, infer what that total thickness is of the continental lithosphere. Okay, you have to start from some crustal model. In this case, this is a long time ago, so we use crust 2.0, and we use its division for the density structure of the crust. And if you followed some of this debate, you will know that what you assume for the thickness and density and layering of the crust is extremely important. And you can get, you know, sort of negative contributions or positive contributions. This is not an easy exercise. So the one innovation that we have is we calculated all the properties of the mantle as a depleted mantle that is some multiplicative factor of the thickness of the lower crust at pressure and temperatures with a self-consistent thermodynamic model. And then we said, average, spherically average, there should be no dynamic topography, and therefore the pressure that you get should match that of Prem at 350 kilometers. So what is the end result? Again, expanded in spherical harmonics, I compared to this is it. This is centered in the Pacific. This is centered in Africa. And we see some sort of dynamic topography here. So there should be positive dynamic topography over Africa, some negative dynamic topography over South America, for example, perhaps over that different slab that Karen showed. And so an okay comparison with what existed, right? Again, at the broadest strokes. But if you look in a bit more detail, that's actually not the case, and I'll show it later. Now, how does that dynamic topography, this residual topography, that it's now maybe minus 1,000 to 1,000, minus 1,200 to 1,200, how does that compare with predictions from convection models, or instantaneous flow models derived from, you know, tomographic models? Right, so here are the predictions from the tomographic models. This is using S20RTS. This is using one of Grant's models. These are peak to peak of 3 kilometers. And you know, these are similar to each other, but maybe not so similar, depending on the data that are used. And these are the comparisons here. So should you see a whole African continent that is elevated? Or should you see something that looks more like this? And should you see, you know, an enormously depressed North America, for example, which is certainly not what we see here? Okay, now what is the problem then? You know, we've done this, there are some similarities, there are obviously some differences. The problem is that when you look regionally, so when you're trying to start to understand what may have gone wrong with the physics, what is the rheology of the mantle, for example, what you find is that the observed signals are inevitably smaller, right? And so how do you look at that? So this is a prediction of dynamic topography from an old paper of mine based just on a subduction history of the mantle, okay? And this is a sort of residual topography derived from a series of sort of sediments on boreholes you know, some work by Nikki White, Willen and White, right? So all the sort of white, the white dots here are related to sediment measurements and sediment isopachs from borehole and data in this region. Okay, so you see broad similarities. Okay, there's no data here, but the fact is that the amplitudes are smaller, right? And they're smaller by sometimes 1,000 meters. And this is true just about everywhere you look, right? So we're talking about significant differences, which means we're missing something. But we're not missing something only in terms of the mantle predictions. We're also missing something in terms of understanding what that observed dynamic topography may be, at least, for example, on continents. This is also, although I'll go through this quickly, this is also true for Africa. Some of this is some of the first work I did on dynamic topography. This is a residual map. This is the prediction. It looks fantastic, except that if you do something slightly different, like Alex Forte did, you get something completely different. And you don't get, you know, sort of an elevated South African craton due to dynamic topography. So what is the reality, right? So this is actually, these are the one I you before. This is the one they did just based on crustal structure. And these are his dynamic topography predictions with two viscosity structures. Okay, so how can we make progress? How can we find out which details do matter? How can we improve our convection models? What sorts of things do we need to take into account? Or if you want, how can we improve our knowledge of the physics of the mantle so that we can start matching geology at the surface level? So I think we can go back to South America as a natural laboratory, because there the variations in something that we know has to enter the mantle, like the slab, and we know has entered the mantle, are such that you can test whether the morphology and the density structure are actually different. So here's a map of South America. These are the seismic ridges I mentioned before. These are the slab contours. We know there are two extended flat segments, one in Argentina, one in Peru. On top of that is the temporal evolution of dynamic topography. I'll talk about that in a second. Here is a reconstruction with seismic and based on seismicity. Another data of Gutscher et al. Of what the Nazca slab looks like. So you see there are a lot of variations. And if we make a sort of 1 by 1 degree interpolation of that, we come up with something that looks like this. You know, it's not the prettiest map, but it includes the flat segments. The Peruvian one is complex. And also the density structure, the colors are related to the delta rho with respect to the mantle. And they include, you know, variations as a function of age. Here is the oldest part and therefore the densest. And in the flat segments, you have a delta rho of zero. Now that's an assumption, but it's an assumption based on some sound data. The one, especially from Argentina, is that you see these are the receiver function stacks similar to what Hitoshi showed from a group in Arizona. And what they see is that at least under the flat segment in Argentina, you find that the flat segment that are, you know, you see the slab, and then you also see extra oceanic crust. You see two Moho reflections, right? And you end up with a 20-kilometer thick crust. A 20-kilometer thick basaltic crust implies quite a thick depleted mantle underneath. And the whole package is, in fact, if you do sort of your simple-minded conversion, negatively buoyant with respect to the mantle. It would actually rise. So we've assumed conservatively that is a delta rho of zero, okay? So that is the evidence, or at least what we're basing it on, to claim that these sides have a thickened crust, right? And I understand there is a new paper coming out from the arrays that they have in Peru that shows the same thing for the Peru segments. Okay, so showing this again, and you'll see the amplitudes in the next slide, you see what a huge difference it makes to input that morphology and to input the complexity in the density structure. Because now, over flat segments, you're getting essentially no subsidence, which you would expect, right? And where you are getting subsidence is at the leading edge of the slab, as you would expect. This reproduces a basin called the Sierras Pampeanas, called the Mar Chiquita Depression right here, okay? But the fact that you get no subsidence there is related to this delta rho. It's not so much the morphology. The morphology will displace the position. It is the actual density structure that matters. You can see that better here, and you actually have some amplitudes. This is a sort of a side view and sort of tilted view where you see the flat segments and on top the dynamic topography, which is now, of course, a lot less, from 500 positive to about, you know, 1,500 or so. And if you take some cross sections of what the dynamic topography might be, the two flat segments, 13 and 32, or 10 and 32 south, compared to the ones that are not flat, which are actually more like at 30 degrees, you see huge difference in the dynamic topography predicted. It's not positive, it's just really small. So you can imagine that if there is an evolution from a normal slab that it's dipping at 30 degrees to one that it's going flat, you will see in the temporal evolution of the sedimentation or the tectonics a change from something that goes, you know, that it's very deep to something that is much shallower. And so that temporal evolution of the dynamic topography, a different element now to what we normally do, actually gives you uplift over flat segments and subsidence on, you know, far away at the leading edge of the trench. Now, can we validate this with real geology? So the answer is yes, otherwise I wouldn't be showing it. So this is a map of Argentina. This is from Federico Davila, my collaborator at the University of Cordoba. And you actually see there are lots of different seismic sections from which he can get sort of the stratigraphy, and therefore the sedimentary thickness and the compaction and the subsidence, which also have a great number of boreholes, so you can actually date the age of the sediments that you see. So for this particular region near the Mar Chiquita Depression, so here is the topography on top. Here is that flat segment. What you see in the plot here, this is a depth in meters. This is distance from the broken foreland, so actually from here rather than the trench. You see what the flexural curve from having the Andes and the, you know, some of the other mountains in here would produce. It would not produce subsidence where you see it in those boreholes. Okay, this is a curve of the total subsidence. That's the difference between a normal slab, say, coming in at 30-degree dip, and one which we think is the evolution in the Andes, and one with a flat segment that is neutrally buoyant. This is what we predict. This is from the data, and this is what we predict from what I just told you. And so what you see is that it reproduces the loci of subsidence very well, okay, but it's off in amplitude still. So obviously, still some work to do. So you can reproduce some of the subsidence, and in fact, we reproduced that in the Amazon as well. Can we find some evidence of this dynamic uplift by going from a normal slab to a flat slab that is neutrally buoyant? So this is that difference in dynamic topography, so where you would predict uplift, right here over the flat segments, and right here, and here in the rest, you'd actually predict subsidence, although not shown so well by the contours. Then you have several curves here, so a flexural profile and so on. But what's important, this is the modern elevation right here. But what you see, and this is our prediction, this is along here, this is the dynamic topography temporal difference. So the dynamic uplift that you would predict from 70 degrees, so around there to around there, which is this red line right here. But what you see in yellow here, this is the formation of paleosol locations that was deposited at sea level. And today, remnants of that formation are actually found way up here in the high relief regions of the Andes. Okay? So it coincides in terms of timing on the change from a normal subduction to a flat system. And is actually, for us, this is not a huge difference in the amount of topography that you're predicting. The point here being that you actually, with details of the geology, you're starting to validate models which are, to a certain extent, still at long wavelengths compared to the geology of the continent, but it's starting to tell you something about what's important for the physics. Now, if you go to Peru, which is the other segment that you have right here, this is Peru right here. These are isopachs of the Acre Basin and the Solimos Basin, and we did the same exercise. In this case, actually recontouring from relocated hypocentral locations, the slab under Peru. This is this mesh over here is the predicted dynamic topography. This is the relocated slab. With relocated hypocenters that match to the slab. This is a model of what a 30-degree dipping slab would look like and the predicted dynamic topography. You can also see it in this map. I realize this doesn't look very good, or at least not to me. It looks out of focus. I know it isn't. I'm just saying that it looks out of focus to me. And so here is the difference between a 30-degree dip. This would be the location of the slab contours, and this would be the present-day sort of flat slab model. You see much more concentrated what you have. And when you take the difference between these two across this section right here, this is what you have. The blue line right here. You have an uplift over the Peruvian Andes Cordillera and something that matches the location in the sub-acre Solimos Basin. What? Done? Okay. Okay. So why that's interesting is because what it means is in the change from the normal subduction to the flat subduction, the Amazon, which used to drain to the west, started draining to the east, which is what's, this is what's illustrated here, which I'm going to skip. But the reason for it, this has been proposed before by the arrival of the slab, is the arrival of the flat slab with that neutrally buoyant segment, which gives you uplift, where extra uplift where the Andes are, and then extra subsidence where the basin is, which fills out and then keeps spilling to the west. Now, I'm gonna skip this slide on the geoid and on the unresolved issues that we have, and just end up with some conclusions right here about what's interesting about dynamic topography and what are the unresolved issues. Or coming back full circle, that details matter. They matter because the slab structure matters in both geometry and buoyancy. And because at least 10% of slabs today are flat, perhaps not all for the same reason, this is something that has to be taken into account when trying to match a mantle process or mantle convection to the surface. The other thing that's important is that the match to geology is not so easy to do at the geological end or at the geophysical end of the lithosphere, right? So residual topographic models are not so easy, and the details of that lithospheric mantle are important and how you talk about how convection works. Things I haven't talked about is the physics. There are physics that are missing, right? There are physics that we still haven't worked out well in terms of plate boundary rheology, which might be very important in terms of what dynamic topography, length scale, and amplitudes you get. But what matters to me is that increasingly in convection, we're doing more regional work, not because we're becoming geologists or maybe because now we have the tools, but actually because those details tell us something about the physics of the mantle. And in the future, we could use those details to say, really find out what the rheology of the asthenospheric wedge is and how it matters for uplift at the surface. So it doesn't matter that you're right in terms of your model right now. It only matters that you take a holistic approach and add together all the things that you know. Thank you.
Okay, thanks very much for this overview. Question from... not young, but junior. Oh, please. Come on. What do we do in that case? What do you do at the Gordon when this happens?
you wait until okay. someone I'll wait. Asks a
okay,
question.
Okay, so we have.
It's very nice to show that how important it is to include the density variations or more, not, I wouldn't say local, but like, yeah, not just region, yeah, regional scale density variations in the, to calculate the residual topography. So I was wondering how much do you think can be gained from including gravity modeling or comparing to it to the geoid to verify the density structure at first before calculating a residual topography?
Right, so there is a lot to be gained because, okay, so ideally you'd have seismic reflection or seismic refraction profiles everywhere plus local gravity. That's not always possible. So a global model, let's say GOES or GRACE, is very useful to get an idea that at least the top, you know, the MOHO thickness, which is very important, perhaps the density across. Now, the problem is that gravity comes contaminated at many wavelengths with different processes, right? So that you have to be careful how you use it. I think it cannot be used exclusively, but I think together, the sort of global sort of models that are coming out now, plus you know local stuff based also on seismology, with you know, it's very important. The problem at the end is that you know the crustal structure at depth is unknown, at least for the continents and even on oceans, right? And it is a big deal. And when I mean a big deal, it is a huge deal. All I have to do is change a few kilometers of that thickness and a very little percentage of that of the density, and you get, you know, radically different results in the isostatic contribution.